Good morning, and welcome to Trinity Sunday Worship with St. Paul's. Welcome to all in the sanctuary, and welcome online to all those that are joining us with the streaming service this morning. Pastor Tim is in Green Bay at annual conference this weekend, working hard, and Melanie and I will be leading the worship service this morning. A few announcements as we get started. Growing Kindness meets Mondays at 6 p.m. The University of Wisconsin Stevens Point Planetarium presentation Monday evening at 7:15 p.m. All are welcome. City band concerts. Everyone's invited Wednesdays at 6:45, Piffner Park. Remember to bring a chair. Our next outdoor worship service will be June 26th. For the 10:30 service, bring a blanket and or chair. Hopefully no raincoats will be needed that Sunday. A reminder of St. Paul's Church Camp, July 24th. Through the 29th. If you'd like more information on that, please call the church office. Other announcements?
My name is Janet Carter, and I'm a member of Senior Time by Seniors. We have planned two events for the summer for the whole congregation, as John had mentioned. The first one, we're going to the planetarium on Monday nights for 3 weeks in a row. The program starts at 7:30. If you want to ride, meet here at the church and we'll carpool, but please let me know because at this point it's just my car. The other event we have planned is going to the city band concert every Wednesday night. If you face a band shell, we'll be over on the left towards the beginning, towards the front. Let's see how many people we can get going to the concert so we can have a United Methodist presence. I think we can get 25 people eventually by the end of the summer. If you have any questions, ask me.
Thank you, Janet. Any other announcements this morning? Remind everybody in the sanctuary today to fill out your attendance card and drop that off in the offering plate as you leave the sanctuary. For those in the sanctuary, if you'd like to wave to one another, and those online, please leave a comment and greet one another in the comment section on the Facebook live stream. We'll now have centering music with Ryan.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson for this morning comes from John 16, verses 12 through 15. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears and will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. Hymn number 2087. Hymn 2087. Our New Testament lesson this morning is from Romans 5, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our afflictions, knowing that affliction produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. And now for young disciples time, Steve.
All right, I'll just let everyone know, Adeline has decided that she doesn't want to be the only kid up in front today, so that's okay. My children's message is actually a little bit longer. It's about a surprise adventure that I had this week that I did not anticipate at all. In Stevens Point, we had an Afghan refugee family, the Hataris, who were here, and a lot of people in our church and in the community have been helping them with everything they need and to fit in and so on. But they never really anticipated moving to Stevens Point, Wisconsin. They were just sort of assigned here because we were ready for them. They really wanted to go to Indianapolis, and they've been waiting for a chance to go to Indianapolis, where hopefully there's a job waiting, where there are relatives, and there have been a number of people working on this project. So it was thought they were going to be going earlier. They, since I think the 1st of June, were staying at a hotel. So a family of five staying in a hotel room, trying to get things organized to leave for Indianapolis. Wednesday evening, the word came around that they could go to Indianapolis. So that's looking good, except the transportation they were hoping for fell through. So you can go there, you can leave your hotel room, you can get on with your life, but we have no way of getting you there. And my wife Jackie was talking to Mary Schultz. Jackie's been involved as a, other people in getting food for the family and all these other things. And I thought, well, if there's a transportation problem, you know, I'm retired. I can drive to Indianapolis. I looked it up on my phone. If you look on Wednesday night, how long it takes you to get to Indianapolis, it's only 6.5 hours going around Chicago. And I thought, well, that's not that bad, you know. Can you guess the rest of the story? But anyway, I let Mary Schultz know that I'd be willing to drive, and it's like, okay, you're gonna be willing to drive if we can find something for you to drive. I'll call you back. So I get a call back. Eric from the refugee organization in Wausau has located a van. He's going to drive it down to the hotel in Plover. All I have to do is show up at 10 o'clock the next morning, and I can drive the van to Minneapolis. And this is a full-sized van. The family can fit in there. There's 4 rows of seats, actually. They put all their stuff in there in one trip. We can get them to Indianapolis. It's perfect. So I get there, and you know, I've never driven a full-size van before, but they have really nice mirrors on the side like they do on a big truck. So that's good. I have about 5 minutes where I'm busy figuring out how do you turn on the lights, the windshield wipers, the cruise control, and I figure out a place I'm going to be using my phone for navigation. I can kind of set it there by the speedometer, and if I don't hit too many bumps or, you know, go too fast or slow, it won't fall over. But it's going to be on interstate the whole way anyway, so not really a big deal. Mary arrives with a bag of snacks, beverages for the kids, and 3 car seats. Have you ever tried to put and install car seats in a car you've never seen before and have no idea? There are little buckles and latches and straps and everything. So by 11 a.m., we actually were ready to leave. All their stuff was in there. The kids were, the seats were, you know, you could tug on them and they didn't move very much anymore. So that was our goal, and we found things to clip them on, you know, and we're rolling out of there. And, you know, it occurred to me, Eric, who I don't know, drove this down from Wausau and borrowed it from someone whose name I don't know. There are Oregon plates on the van. It has a Wisconsin Park sticker on there, so there's some kind of connection here. I've got 5 people from another country who I've pretty much just met, who don't speak English much. And as it turned out, we didn't actually have an address yet in Indianapolis. They were going to get back to us with that on the way. So at 11 o'clock, we pull out. When, if this story just gets too long, let me know. But it's interesting to me because I think I had the fun part of all of this. Got as far as Madison. We needed gas. And, you know, we're pulling into the Quick Trip, and I have no idea which side you put the gas in. So we pull over. We walked around, Saeed and I, like twice around there, and finally on page 120 of the owner's manual, it reveals where the secret door is that opens up that lets you put gas in there. So we had that, and then it's like what kind of food is appropriate for a Muslim family, and the kids love pizza, so we got vegetarian pizza, went to a park and everything. I guess I do have some pictures here, but I'll stop for a moment. I don't know if these are, but this is my great big van here. It really was pretty nice. And you know, we're like packed. Obviously that isn't a car seat we're using, just sitting loose on the top there. But here's some of the family in the van. If you can see that. Let's see, what else have I got? And not much. I thought we would have some kids, so I was going to ask them to guess their favorite food, which turns out to be pizza was acceptable in the diet. So we went to Pizza Hut, played in the playground and everything else. So just to, you know, this story could get longer, but anyway, the idea is we're going to go to Rockford and then turn and go around Chicago. But when we get close to that, Google Maps says, you know, it's like there's a traffic slowdown, accident report ahead. We're going to send you on a different route. Well, if you plan on going to Chicago, you know, you're anticipating that you're going to see more houses as time goes on and fewer cornfields and things like that. But have any of you ever been to Champaign, Illinois? Yes. Well, I have too, because I really didn't have enough time to like try to fiddle with the map thing, and it's like I just trusted that we would get there. So we went slightly longer to Champaign. In the meantime, I'm listening to Afghan music. Saeed figured out how to plug his phone in, so we were listening to tunes on our way there. He commented that it's, and he doesn't have a lot of English, but it's all the same, by which he meant it's flat everywhere here. And I found out in Kabul, everything's mountainous and there are no speed limits on the roads. Other things, their favorite beverage is Red Bull for the whole family. They got some as a treat, and it was a little surprising to me when the four-year-old popped it open and started drinking it. And they had one for me as well, and I tried to explain, no, I was a dentist and I just think this stuff is like horrible for your teeth, but you know, he goes, it's good. So anyway, we let that go. As we were getting closer to Indianapolis, and you know, it ended up taking about 8 hours altogether to get there. You know, you'd expect them to be tired and maybe disappointed knowing that they're not going to their, you know, their new place to live, but just to a hotel. But they are getting more and more excited. They're phoning. Saeed was on his phone all the time, talking to different people, honestly, all over the country. And he's giving them reports like, you know, 57 minutes, we're supposed to be there, and that sort of thing. So instead of getting more and more tired, they are getting more and more excited. When we finally pull up to the hotel, they did get back to us from the agency in Indianapolis, asked if we needed anything. Asked if we had food for when they got there, said someone would come and check on them the next day. We got to the hotel and it was very nice. There were 3 bags of groceries, diapers the right size for the baby. It was the kind of units where they have a little kitchen in there. So a refrigerator, a stove with 4 burners, and you know, a sink and dishes and everything else. So this is much better than where they left, and everything's being taken care of. But I mean, the real part of this story that is like really gets you here is there was somebody waiting for us at the door when we pulled up to this hotel, and it was Saeed's cousin. Okay, it gets very confusing because Saeed's cousin had just arrived from Qatar the day before. He'd spent one night at the hotel and he told me his whole thing, and his family was there, and as best I can determine, we have 2 Saeeds. The cousin is also Saeed. So it's like 2 cousins married 2 sisters. because it was confusing. It's like, he's my cousin, but she's my wife's sister. And they're across the hall in the hotel. So we get there, he's there, they have kids. There's chicken wings in a pot of broth or something cooking on the stove in the other family's apartment. And, you know, we can only imagine what it's like to be separated from your family when you came from a war zone. You haven't seen each other, you're in a strange place, and you lay eyes on each other for the first time. Like I say, you know, we can try to imagine what that might feel like, but at least I can say I got to see what that's like. It's just amazing. It's one of those running across the parking lot for each other. It's like talk, 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 smile, smile, smile. So people have been saying, well, thank you for driving all the way to Indianapolis. And I have to tell you, it was a joy of my life to drive to Indianapolis. I did not get stopped on the road. I did not have to answer any questions about the vehicle. I got the gas in it. Jackie and I actually drove up to Wausau to return it to the true owner. We found out who that was. So this is the two Saeeds here. I mean, it's a little far away, but my goodness, they were so happy to see each other. I mean, the other message that they have for everybody here who's helped with their care of the whole family is how grateful, and they realize how much work and effort went in specifically to taking care of them, and they could not be more grateful. They feel that they have two families, and one of them is here in Stevens Point. So on behalf of their family, I want to say thank you to everybody, you know, here who has helped and worked on this whole project. It actually fits pretty well with our scripture lesson, I think, from Romans, where we have something about Paul says, don't be worried about running into problems. Problems make you look for solutions. Solutions make you stronger. Being stronger makes you a person better able to receive God's salvation. And know how much God loves you and how he has filled our lives with his Holy Spirit. So I think I experienced a lot of that this week, and I'll finish not with a formal prayer, but just a couple of things from Mary Schultz's text message to everybody, where she was trying to get them, you know, caught up, where she says, is God good or what? Our team has been such a godsend for this family. Thank you for being such great extensions of God's love. And with that, I guess I'd finish like we usually do with children's messages and prayers. And all God's people said, amen. Okay, thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Steve. Thank you for driving, for sharing the story with us, and for all those adventures. Thank you.
Honey, what you doing there with all that paperwork?
Oh, good morning, love. Well, I'm trying to figure out some of this Medicare, Medigap, drug insurance sort of stuff. This benefit program, that one, this costs this much, over here it's that. But the one you can get super sneakers or golden sneakers for, that's kind of interesting. But this other one over here, They'll send you a horseshoe. It's called the Golden Horseshoe Club or something like that. And they send you a horseshoe to put up over your door for good luck for being in their program. That costs a lot of money, but golden horseshoes, you know, they might be pretty good there. But anyway, I'm still,
I haven't seen you in a pair of sneakers in 40 years. I don't think we need to sign up for that one.
Well, there's 42 other different programs we can sign up for if you don't like that one. I like the horseshoe one. That sounds kind of interesting.
I'm really glad it's you doing that, not me. I get frustrated even trying to understand that Social Security stuff. I really appreciate you now more than ever that we're at that stage of life that we have to wade through this huge process to apply for our benefits. If I wasn't married to you, I'd end up one of the homeless old ladies at a shelter. Really, honey, it's so complicated. When to start collecting Social Security, picking a supplement, changing all the health information for all your providers, setting up online accounts, constantly double checking that we are getting all the benefits we've earned. You've worked your whole life to get to retirement to find out it's a full-time job managing your retirement. How does everyone else do it?
Well, it helps that we've had financial advisors along the way that have laid out a rough road map for us to follow. What to do first, and the questions to ask. And then there are some online tools and seminars that have helped also.
I've gone to some of those, the ones that have free dinner. I like going to those, but I can't say I was ever really focused on the material. The truth is I'm just not interested because most of it involves math. I hate math in any form. I'm a musician. I did learn to count to 8, maybe 12, sometimes. And I'm a carpenter, and I can figure out board feet and measure stuff competently. But that's all the math I need. That's all the math I want. That's all.
You have a bad attitude about math, Melanie. You're a bright woman. You could do it if you wanted. You just don't want to.
That's right. I don't want to. I want you to do it for me, for us. You take care of all those benefits. I trust you to do that.
Speaking of benefits, that's the theme of the scripture reading we're going to talk about on Sunday.
Social Security benefits? Job benefits? Oh, that reminds me of that story about the engineering student who graduated from Michigan Tech and went on his first job interview.
Oh boy, this should be good.
The kid sits down in front of the HR interviewer, who asks some general questions about his interests, his educational experiences, his career goals, and then asks, "Tell me, what do you think your starting salary should be for your first job? What are you expecting to earn if you get employment with us?" The young man doesn't hesitate. "Well, I think $250,000 a year would be acceptable, depending on the benefits package." Well, the interviewer doesn't seem fazed by this. "Well," she says, "how about this for a benefits package? You get 5 weeks paid vacation, 14 paid holidays, full medical and dental insurance. We match retirement up to 50% of your salary. You get a leased car every 2 years. Let's say a red Corvette." The young man sits up and says, "Wow, are you kidding?" "Yes," she says, "but you started it."
Oh, that's funny. But those are not the benefits I am talking about.
I know. You're talking about the benefits that come with a relationship with Christ. Benefits that come from belonging to the church,
I'm not talking about a church with a sanctuary or a parking lot or a denominational affiliation, but the church of believers in Jesus Christ and the justification that comes from faith in him.
Paul wrote a lot about benefits. It's a long list. Not sure how many we could come up with. Let's see. No judgment for believers in Christ.
Empowerment over sin.
Real peace.
The Holy Spirit will live in you.
Gift of eternal life.
Abundant life and healing.
Adopted as a son or daughter.
Authority, not slavery.
Intimacy with God.
A priceless inheritance.
The Holy Spirit to help when we are weak.
The Holy Spirit will intercede for us.
God causes all things to work together for good.
And God gives us his glory.
God is for us.
And God gives us everything else.
Jesus pleads for us at God's right hand.
Overwhelming victory is ours.
Nothing can separate us from God's love.
He gives the fruit of the Spirit. And that's not all of them, that's just some of them from Paul's letters.
Now, Paul was a head human resource recruiter for the church. He knew all about the benefits and wanted every member of the company to know about them also.
Well, even the Old Testament makes mention of the benefits of walking with God. In the Psalms, we hear about God daily loading us with his benefits, like a deposit to our debit card, every single day.
Yes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. David goes on in Psalm 103 to make a list similar to Paul's, but without those benefits that could only be realized after the sacrifice of Christ.
The passage from Romans 5 for this morning follows chapter 4, which is an explanation of justification by faith. Wow, that's a mouthful. The reality that we are all sinners. Not one of us is righteous. We are all guilty. If we judge ourselves by the Ten Commandments, we have all failed. And we are sentenced to death. But Jesus paid the death penalty for each of us who believes in him. In him, we become justified. That word means just as if we had never sinned. We don't access the benefits because of anything that we do. It's because of what Christ has done for us. It's because of the man with the five wounds. He is the reason we stand among the redeemed. Our faith in his sacrifice. Not our good works, our baptism, our confirmation, our church attendance. Without faith in the work of Christ, we have nothing. And when we get to Romans 5, Paul expounds on four basic benefits of faith and justification.
First, we realize we can have peace with God. The war with God is over. Whether you feel it or not, you have peace with God if you have received the sacrifice of Christ. Without Christ, sin is a roadblock to peace with God. You might feel peaceful without Christ. You might feel very peaceful, very unstressed, but you are like the person relaxing in a lounge chair on the deck of the Titanic. You might feel fine, but the boat is going down. Your peace is a temporal thing and subject to circumstances, but the cross made true peace possible. When you accept the work of the cross, you have peace with God. It's a done deal, whether you feel it or not. But as you grow in the understanding of what that justification means, you will begin to experience the peace of God. The peace mentioned in Philippians 4 reads that you can be anxious for nothing. So peace with God leads to the peace of God. First is fact, second is a feeling. Jesus as Savior brings peace with God. Jesus as Lord brings the peace of God. Christ is the Prince of Peace.
And the second benefit we get, access to God. Through him, Jesus, we have access to the Father. Jesus clothes us in his righteousness, because ours is his filthy rags, so we can approach the Father and meet with him. Jesus said, "No man can come to the Father except by me." You know, 2,000 years ago, the idea of intimacy and access to God was unheard of in both paganism and Judaism. The Greek and Roman gods were angry, petulant, and cantankerous. They were not to be approached just to be placated. Judaism was different, but not a whole lot better. No one could just run into the tabernacle and the Holy of Holies and have some quiet time in prayer. You'd be zapped dead. There were separation walls and little areas called courts. The Gentiles were way back. Jewish women had a space that was a little bit closer. Jewish men could go closer still, but only so far. The priests could get close enough to hang out around the holy place, but only the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies, and then only once a year, briefly, carefully. He went with bells on his robe and a rope tied around his ankle, so just in case he died in there, they would know and could drag his body out. Well, they'd think, well, maybe he displeased God. Maybe he forgot to feed his donkey this morning. Doesn't matter. He's dead. We got to find somebody else for that job.
But that all ended at the cross. When Jesus died, a significant event happened. The veil, the curtain, was torn from top to bottom. No longer is the Holy of Holies curtained off from man. We who were afar off can be brought near by the blood of Christ. We can come boldly into God's dwelling place, no matter what we have done, no matter how we look that day. Jesus broke down the wall, and we are welcome into the holy place anytime. God said, "Y'all come now," and we can come boldly to the throne of grace and find help in time of need. That is a benefit, living in the presence of God.
So, being justified by faith, we are anchored in the past at the cross. Jesus made peace with God a fact for us, and the peace of God a reality we attain as we grow in our Christian life.
And we are anchored in the present as we continually take advantage of our access to God, freely given to his sons and daughters.
The third benefit Paul talks about anchors us to the future, hope. We rejoice in our hope, something that's future, the hope of seeing the glory of God. Paul said, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. This is a reference to heaven. Heaven is where God's glory will be fully displayed for us. The best is yet to be. Moses once asked to see God's glory, and he had already experienced so many miraculous things with God. God spoke to him audibly. A bush had lit up before him. He saw God split the sea and drowned his enemies. He saw water flow from a rock and bread rain down from heaven. Yet he still asked to see God's glory. His earthly experiences were not enough.
We will have glorified bodies to look forward to. Personally, I'm getting tired of this one. Retirement to heaven gives me hope for sure. When he appears, we shall be like him.
In the meantime, I'll love you in whatever state you're in. Jesus did pray that we would see his glory, and I believe Jesus gets what he prays for. Peter said in 1 Peter 1:3, "In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead." Peter's really interesting. He was a fisherman. Here was his daily life. Got up in the morning, he fished. Every day. It was his job. He didn't have the bumper sticker that said, "I'd rather be fishing," because probably he wouldn't. He got up every morning, he went out on the Sea of Galilee, he threw out nets all day, he went home and went to bed. I bet he thought once or twice, "Is this all there is to life? Day after day?" But one day Peter met Jesus, and Jesus said, "Peter, come and follow me. I'll give you a new job. I will make you a fisher of men." So Peter went with him. It was exciting following Jesus. It lasted 3 years, and then something happened. Jesus died. And when Jesus died, Peter's hope died with him. Walking along the road after the crucifixion, Peter and two of the others were met by a stranger. They talked to the man about Jesus and said, "And we had hoped in him." Their hope was dead. But then there was a resurrection, and hope was reborn. A hope that wouldn't die because Jesus won't die again. If Jesus can rise from the dead, then every promise he made is true. Peace with God. Peter then had a living hope that would never die. Yeah, we have lots of benefits, past, present, and future.
But wait, there's more.
This sounds like a commercial coming on. But wait, that's not all. Order now and get an extra product free. And we'll throw in free shipping too.
Well, maybe you want to wait and hear this before you say that. Right here, we also glory in tribulations.
Tribulations? You're right. I don't want to hear that part. But I know that salvation isn't a fairy tale. We will experience heartache, pain, and suffering as part of life. Jesus said, "In the world we will have tribulations, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world."
That's right. Justification is not an escape from trials, but a guarantee that trials will not overcome us. The trials have purpose. They will work for us, not against us. All things work together for good for those who love God. They produce perseverance, character, and hope. We can glory in tribulations. We should rejoice, Paul says. Unbelievers can't rejoice because this life is all there is for them. Believers know there is something on the other side. No matter how dark the night is, there is a morning on the other side for us. Look at Joseph, his life. Human trafficked by his own brothers. Sold as a slave to Egypt. Falsely accused. Imprisoned. Yet in the end, he said to his brothers, "All you meant for evil, God turned to good." Justification is not escape from tribulations, but an assurance that our trials have purpose and that we will understand in the end and rejoice.
So the lesson today is all about benefits. Peace with God, access to God, hope to be with God in glory, and purpose in our trials until we get to glory. Those trials in our lives produce character and hope because God's love is poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has been given to us.
In our benefit package, we see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit working together on our behalf to ensure we have believers' benefits. If you have received that forgiveness and justification by believing in the sacrifice of Christ for you, then you already have those benefits. You've got the enrollment card. You've got life to use those benefits for the glory of Christ. Get in touch with those benefits and gifts given to you that you might serve Him diligently. Don't let those benefits go unused.
Yes, He's the greatest boss in the world. How hard is it to apply for benefits?
Not hard. There's no paperwork, no endless phone calls on hold while waiting for the next available operator. And you won't get turned down or put on a waiting list. Spiritual benefits are there for the asking, and they've already been paid for.
Anyone can do that. And you need to do it for yourself. Like, I couldn't ask you to do it for me. Just a prayer to the Savior to become one of the justified, forgiven, one of the family, one of the company of saints. You're sure there's no algebra involved?
Absolutely no algebra involved. Hey, we need to get moving. It's almost time to leave for church.
All right.
And next is hymn number 64, Holy, Holy, Holy. Hymn number 64. Thank you. And now we come to a time of sharing our joys and concerns. I have a list of prayers and concerns, and we'll go through that for those online. If you'd be so kind as to share any prayers and concerns that you have in the chat section, I'll try to find all those. And for those in the sanctuary, please, as we get to that time, get a microphone so everybody can hear. Prayer requests that have come in. Prayers for George Davidson's friends, Mary, Bob, and Mike, who struggle with health issues. Prayers for the family of Melba Sullivan. Melba passed away on Monday. A funeral service will be held Saturday, June 18th at 11 a.m., with visitation beginning at 10 a.m. Prayers for Tom and Carol Rogers, Pat Doherty, and Lois Kiddo. Prayers for Jim and Julie Cormack for their health issues. Continued prayers for Jaden, who is struggling with leukemia. Prayers for the people of Ukraine. Pray for peace in our world. Continued prayers for Dave and Melanie Patterson's friend, Rick Riley, as he recovers from a stroke. We pray for Ann, our harpist friend, who finishes radiation and chemo this week as the doctors and medical staff decide next steps for Ann. We lift up the annual conference with Pastor Tim and others that are meeting this week in Green Bay. Mary Schultz online, prayers of thanksgiving for Steve, who drove our Afghan family all the way to Indianapolis with all their belongings. We are so grateful for his wonderful donation of time and friendship. From Vern Walters, thank you, Steve, Mary, and the refugee team for a successful transition. Peggy Meyer, may the Holy Spirit continue to richly guide our refugee team, our beautiful refugees, in deepest gratitude. And Vern saying thank you for the service this morning. Mary Landreth, prayers for Tom, Carol, Pat, and Lois. And another thank you for Steve and the refugee group. And for people in the sanctuary here, sharing concerns or joys, please.
I would just like to thank everyone for their prayers. My sister Betty is home now, and the blood infection is clearing up, and she's doing much better. Thank you.
Jim?
I have a joy to share. On Tuesday, Kathy and I will be celebrating 48 years of marriage.
Today is Glenn and my wedding anniversary, and I also have a third great-granddaughter that will be baptized today in Minnesota.
Are there others? Father, we thank you that we can come boldly to your throne and lift up these prayer concerns and joys before you. You know the thoughts of our heart. You know our concerns and prayers, spoken and unspoken. We pray that you would work your will through the concerns that have been lifted up. We give you the praise and the glory for the joys. And together we pray the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. As we celebrate our offering time together, many thanks to the various ways the congregation has continued giving and blessing others through the many gifts. We're still not passing the offering plate in the services. You can leave your offering in the plate in the gathering area as you leave the sanctuary. You can also mail a check to the church office at 600 Wiltshire Boulevard, or you can go to the website, StevensPointUMC.org, and there is a button there to donate online. O God of abundance, there are no limits to the gifts you have given us, no limits to your blessings, no limits to your love. We give thanks for this opportunity to make a difference as we share and support our ministries that touch this world, that bring about your kingdom. Help these gifts to expand your grace and hope throughout the world. Bless our sharing and our giving, we pray. Amen. And our closing hymn will be 3150. Father, we have heard you calling. 3150. Thank you. Lord, we thank you for this day, for this time to gather together in worship, whether online or in this place. We thank you for your many benefits, Lord. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that leads us into all wisdom. Go forth, enjoy this great week, remember all his benefits, and share them with others to draw them unto Christ. Amen.